Welcome to you all on this fine morning. Many thanks to Kevin Rose for waking up the pipes of our organ this morning to welcome you into this loving community. Welcome to you here in our physical sanctuary. Welcome to you who are joining us online in our Zoom sanctuary. We are one community this morning under this finally blue sky. Welcome to you, whoever you are. Whoever you have been, whoever you are becoming, you are welcome here. You are welcome with your hopes and your dreams, your fears and your anxieties. You are welcome with all of you in this space as we enter into this time together on this Easter morning. We are a loving community of seekers here at the Unitarian Society of Santa Barbara, where we strive to live with integrity, nurture wonder, and inspire the actions that transform us and transform the world. I'm the Reverend Julia Hamilton, and I am joined this morning by Matthew Grissett, our music director, and our wonderful choir and musicians, by Charlotte Brigante, our director of Lifespan Religious Exploration. And this morning, we are an all-ages service, which means that families are invited to stay together in the service this morning. We have a little bit of an interactive service. We've got a table set up over here on the side. If anybody has the inkling to make some crafts with their hands while they listen, they're welcome to join Janie over there at any time. And we do have childcare available for our littlest ones in Star King. So feel free to come and go as it suits your needs this morning. We have a lot going on here at the Unitarian Society, so I'd like to extend a special welcome to any visitors, friends and guests, family members here in this room joining us from afar. We have a connection card. It's that yellow card in your order of service, or online there's a link in the Zoom chat. And if you drop that in the offertory plate or stop stop by our welcome table or fill it out online. It will let us keep connected with you about all the ways you can get involved in this community beyond Sunday morning. And we have a lot coming up as we turn towards spring. But first, I can see that there's maybe just a little syrup stuck around some of you this morning. I can smell the pancakes from Parish Hall, and I want to say thank you to Peter Hale and everyone who made our pancake breakfast this morning possible. It's always so fun when you sense a new tradition emerging, and our pancake breakfasts have become something joyful and wonderful and a gift. So thank you for everyone who makes it possible, and hopefully you can join us next time if you couldn't be there in person for pancakes this time. If this coming week, continuing our food theme, our environmental film series is bringing Just Eat It into Parish Hall about food justice and food waste and how we can get better at the way we consume and nourish ourselves. So everyone is invited to join the environmental justice film series happening in Parish Hall this coming week. Also in Parish Hall, the Alliance is meeting on Friday afternoon, and it'll be an opportunity to hear from Carolyn Bjerke, our intern minister, who is here with us for the next year and a half. So if you want to get a chance to meet Carolyn, join the Alliance for that special presentation on Friday afternoon. And also with the food theme, I'm loving this food theme emerging in the congregation. We have our potluck coming up next Sunday. So go ahead and bring a dish to share and join us after the service for community and fun and delicious food provided by the community. We are still figuring out potlucks on Zoom, but if you have ideas, let us know. And now I invite you to take a breath, to allow yourself to fully arrive here into this space, to set aside whatever busyness you might be bringing with you into this moment and give yourself the gift of this hour together as I ring our bell and let the sound connect us.
I would like to invite the Stuart Davis family forward to light our chalice this morning. Come on up. Lighting the path as they come. And these are our chalice lighting words this morning. Come in with all of yourself, just as you are, for here is a place for the living, a place for all of life, this momentary, mundane, miraculous mess. Here is a place for the remembering, all of it, all of ourselves, and the ways we remain connected in this common course, held in a love that through it all calls us on.
Let us rise in body and spirit to sing together this song, Morning Has Broken, number 38 in the gray hymnal or the words on your screen.
Fresh from the world, sweet.
Good morning. Can I borrow some kids over from the activity corner to come up for a story? We need some helpers this morning. You'll be able to get back there.
Yeah.
Oh, one of our littlest ones is here. Oh, I think you should be in childcare. You're a little young for this, but.
I'm 14.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe
come
you
on
can
up.
Stay
We're going to need some help today.
Come on up. Oh, here's another little tiny one coming up. Welcome, everyone. Welcome, welcome. It's nice to see you all. All right. Julia's little baby is here, too. So great. So Easter, like Christmas, is one of those holidays that blends Christian and pagan traditions and symbols. On Christmas, Christians celebrate the birth of Jesus, who they believe is the Son of God. On Easter, they celebrate his life and death. The name Easter comes from a pre-Christian goddess of spring named Oestra. And the Easter holiday is always celebrated, I didn't know this until today, always celebrated on the Sunday following the first full moon after the spring equinox. Who knew that? Did people know that? People knew that. I didn't know that. Easter eggs are, of course, a big part of the Easter tradition. In many cultures, eggs are a symbol of new life and rebirth. And Christians have adopted the symbol of the egg to represent Jesus' emergence from the tomb. As Unitarian Universalists, we believe that understanding stories connected to major holidays is important, and that every tradition has important wisdom to share. This morning, we're going to revisit the Easter story from the Christian tradition. To some of the grown-ups in our congregation, this will be an old, familiar story. For some of you, it might be brand new. So whether you're hearing this tale for the first time or the 101st time, I hope you will find some wisdom in it. Okay, so let me take you back to a time long ago, about 2,000 years ago, to a land called Judea, where a Jewish prophet and teacher named Jesus of Nazareth taught people about God's love. He said that God loved every single person and that all people were equal in God's eyes. Word of his teaching spread through the land, and people came from all over to hear what he had to say. Judea was ruled by the powerful Roman Empire, which was harsh and cruel. The people were unhappy, and there was great unrest in the land. The Roman governor, a man named Pontius Pilate, was afraid Jesus would lead the people in a revolt against Rome. He considered Jesus a dangerous troublemaker. Although Jesus knew his life was in danger, this didn't stop him from preaching his message of love and peace. When Jesus arrived in Jerusalem for Passover, people greeted him, waving palm branches and laying them on the ground where he walked.
So this is where I'm gonna need a little help from a volunteer. I need someone to help me find an egg. Who's ready for that this morning? Maeve, you wanna try to find one? Okay, so if you look over here, there's a basket, and can you look for the green egg, Maeve? Oh, Simon, you'll get a chance next time. You can be the next up. We've got more than one egg, luckily. And you can go after Simon. All right, so Maeve, can you open that up? And what do you find inside that green egg? What is that? Can you hold that up maybe and show everybody? It looks like maybe a palm branch. So palm branches are an ancient symbol of victory and goodness and well-being. And that's what people waved and laid on the ground when Jesus arrived in Jerusalem. You can go ahead and sit back down and hold on to that egg if you want.
In Jerusalem, Jesus met with 12 of his closest friends who were called disciples. Passover was in 2 days, Jesus said. We shall all meet for the Passover Seder and eat together. And here's a side note. Passover is a Jewish holiday, and we will be celebrating Passover here at the Unitarian Society with a Seder on April 27th. Sign up now. Okay, back to Jesus after that commercial break. One of Jesus' disciples, a man named Judas, found out that Jesus' enemies wanted to capture him. Judas met with them in secret. He offered to point Jesus out to them in return for 30 pieces of silver. They agreed to the bargain. Jesus and his 12 disciples gathered together for the Passover Seder. Christians call this meal the Last Supper. Jesus looked at his disciples with great sadness. "One of you will betray me to my enemies," he said. The words Jesus spoke upset the disciples. They stared at each other in horror. Who would betray him? After the meal, Jesus brought his disciples to the Garden of Gethsemane to sit with him while he prayed to God for strength and courage.
So Simon and Dylan, I'm going to ask you to help me out with finding another egg, and maybe you can go over and can you find a blue egg in that basket, Simon? If you want to go look right up in the front there, there's, and Janie can help you. Is there a, can you find a blue egg there? And can you go bring that over to Dylan and have him open it up for us? Dylan, would you open this egg up for us? What do you find inside that egg?
I need to
do you want to hold it up so maybe everybody can see? Hold it up high for everybody can see. It looks like, what does it look like?
Flower.
A flower, a white flower, maybe a white Easter lily. Easter lilies symbolize honesty and purity, and it's said that that Garden of Gethsemane where he went that night was full of white lilies. So that's one of the reasons why it's a symbol for Easter.
Suddenly, Jesus' disciple Judas arrived in the garden with a large band of Roman soldiers. He went up to Jesus and kissed his hand. This was the signal the enemies were waiting for. They drew swords, surrounded Jesus, and led him away. Terrified, the disciples fled. When Judas saw what had happened, he regretted what he had done. He tried to return the silver, but it was too late. The soldiers took Jesus to a place called Golgotha, where he was sentenced to a cruel death by being nailed to a large wooden cross, which is how the Romans crucified those they considered troublemakers. Before he died, Jesus asked God to forgive those who had betrayed him. He said, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do."
I need another volunteer. Anybody else want to help me out this morning? You want to help me out, Rowan? Can you find a gold egg, a shiny gold one? Yeah, that one right there. Can you open it up and see what you find inside? What is that? The cross. Can you hold it up so folks can see it? Maybe folks online. Right. So for Christians, the cross symbolizes this resurrection and Jesus' message of love and peace that survives through death.
Jesus' followers were, of course, sad and frightened. One of Jesus' followers was a man named Joseph of Arimathea. Did I say that right?
Arimathea.
Arimathea.
Lots of pronunciation challenges in ancient texts.
Yes. He asked Pontius Pilate for permission to bury Jesus. Joseph tenderly wrapped the body of Jesus in fine white linen and laid him in a tomb of rock. Mary Magdalene and Jesus' mother Mary watched in sadness and grief as Joseph rolled a large stone in front of the entrance to close the tomb. 3 days passed. Jesus' mother and Mary Magdalene came to the tomb, bringing spices to anoint the body and prepare it for a proper burial.
I need another volunteer. Who wants to help me find? You want to help me find another egg? Can you go look for the orange egg in that basket? You want to bring it up here and then open it up for me? And what do you see? There's a little packet in there. Look at that, a little packet of maybe it looks like spices and herbs, seasonings. The spices symbolize the women who were followers of Jesus and their love for him.
As the women walked, they talked about how hard it would be to roll away the heavy stone. But to their surprise, when they arrived at the tomb, they found the stone already rolled away. They looked inside the tomb and found that it was empty. Jesus' body was gone. The women ran from the place, frightened, and told others what they had seen.
Do I have another volunteer?
Leo's.
Do you want to help me out, Leo? Can you find a purple egg? Is there a purple egg in that basket? Come on up here. And if you hold up, what is it? Nothing? It's empty? It's an empty egg? Imagine the surprise when they found an empty tomb. The emptied egg represents the empty tomb and the Christian belief that Jesus was resurrected and ascended to heaven. It's always surprising when we're expecting to find something
but don't find anything. But don't worry, Leo, there'll be other eggs to find.
There's going to be many more eggs to find with some treats inside them, so don't worry, you'll get some treat-filled eggs later on this morning.
Soon after that tragic moment, Jesus' disciples and followers began to talk with one another about the lessons Jesus had taught them, about how he had given them hope and made them feel loved. Some of his followers said they had seen him again after he died, that his body had been resurrected and taken up to heaven, and that his work would continue even though he was no longer among them.
Do you want to look for another egg? There's one more in the basket. Leo, do you want to come? Do you want to come? Let's let Leo come have another shot at this. What do you find in that egg? Can you lift it up and show everybody? What is it? A butterfly, a beautiful butterfly inside that egg. Butterfly, a symbol of transformation and rebirth, and perhaps a renewal of hope.
This is what the Christian story of Easter is all about. Sharing the story of Jesus's life and death and celebrating his message of love and hope, remembering that love is stronger than cruelty and even death. Like Jesus, Unitarian Universalists believe that everyone is deserving of love. The work of building a more just and loving world is passed down through the generations, and with the work, the hope, joy, and celebration that sustains it. Happy Easter. And now I invite the kids to go make a bag for future egg hunting coming up.
Thank you to everyone for helping us tell the Easter story. And there are definitely, you'll hear more about the egg hunt that's going to be happening after the service as well. How appropriate it seems that Easter falls on March 31st this year. March 31st today is also Transgender Day of Visibility. What a better way to honor our capacity for a transformation, resurrection, and renewal. Celebrating with our trans and gender non-conforming siblings who have embodied renewal and resurrection for generations. There was a big celebration hosted by the Santa Barbara Transgender Advocacy Network right here at the Unitarian Society yesterday evening, and I am so grateful that our campus provides a safe and welcoming place for our trans community here in Santa Barbara all year long. Yes, we can applaud that and shout some hallelujahs if you want. This is the kind of morning you can shout hallelujah if you want it. This joyful annual holiday of celebration is a partner with the more somber Trans Day of Remembrance, which happens in November. Trans Day of Visibility is all about celebrating the beauty of trans lives and affirming everyone's right to live joyfully, safely, and authentically as themselves. It honors change and growth as a sacred process, and it is an affirmation that trans lives are divine and lifts up the community of love and support that we work to create every day. Trans Day of Visibility also honors the fact that not every trans and gender non-conforming person can live openly in the world, but we work to make that dream real, that one day barriers will fall and closet doors will fly open and a spirit of love and acceptance will prevail. So in honor of this day, as we enter into a time of meditation and reflection and prayer, I would like to share with you this prayer by the Reverend Gretchen Haley and invite you in the moment of quiet that follows to extend your love and compassion to all those who are fighting for the right to be themselves, beloved and brave, in the face of increasing threat and hostility in our world. So settle yourself where you are, listen to the sounds of life in the room, perhaps, get in touch with your breath, soften your gaze. When Jesus declares even death cannot hold him back, maybe what he means to say is nothing can keep you from the life you were meant for. Closets, like tombs, are no match for the power of a person radically willing to forge their own path, proclaim their own name, transgress norms, transfuse truths, transform the elements, transfix the world in a story of love that transcends binaries and belief systems. Love that calls all of our stories sacred and calls us all beloved. When the crocuses find their way through the snow and the rocks, maybe what they mean to say is we see you, transmitting light even in these darkest of days, transcribing the future on our hearts, transversing borders of gender and transitioning this world from judgment to joy like it's our birthright. For of course it is. For this day and this life is a gift given to us all equally, a transparent miracle inviting us all finally to be free. May it be so. Let us enter into a time of quiet. You could stay seated right where you are as we sing together hymn number 123, Spirit of Life.
Spirit.
So what is this hunt for justice we've been talking about all month anyway? Right after the service, or towards the end of the service, the kids are going to go out into the courtyard out there for a very special egg hunt. The Easter story reminds us that working to build a more loving world is hard and sometimes dangerous work, but that joy and celebration are important too. That is why in our congregation we combine a joyful egg hunt with loving generosity in our Easter hunt for justice. Back in February, you all generously supported the hunt for justice. 25% of our offering that month, plus any specially designated donations, was put aside for the Easter morning hunt for justice. That amount came to $475 this year. Then early in March, our RE children made a list of causes of things that they care about. These included people without homes, animals, bees, people who are dying, their families, the ocean, and science, among other things. Our kids care a lot about a lot of things. My homework was to identify organizations doing good work for these causes and bring them to the kids to vote on. In order for us to make a meaningful donation, the kids would need to narrow down the organizations to their top three. This year, they chose Hospice of Santa Barbara, the Museum of Natural History Planetarium, and Heal the Ocean. Right after the service today, the kids will hunt for eggs, and inside each egg, there is a chocolate treat to eat and a wooden coin. Each coin is worth a little over $6, and kids will bring their coins to the stage in Parish Hall and distribute them among three baskets that represent each of the nonprofits as they see fit. So they get to distribute the money how they want to. This is one way we combine joy and celebration with the work of building a better world. Thank you.
As Sharla mentioned, every month we give away a portion of our offering to programs and projects that live our values in the world, and we hope to pass that ethic on to the future generations as well. This month, this is the final Sunday of our outreach offering for PFLAG, which goes to support families, friends, and the LGBTQ community here in Santa Barbara and around our country. So please read with me the affirmation of gratitude and giving that is in your order of service and on the screen. Let us be grateful when we are able to give, for many do not have that privilege. Let us be grateful for those who share their gifts with us, for we are enriched by their giving. And let us be grateful even for our needs, so that we may learn from the generosity of others.
It's been a long, dark night, and I've been waiting. waiting for the morning. It's been a long, hard fight, but I see a brand new day dawning. I've been looking for the sunshine, 'cause I ain't seen it in so long. Everything's gonna work out fine. Everything's gonna be okay, be okay. I can see the light of a clear blue morning. I can see the light of a brand new day. I can see the light of a clear blue morning. Everything's gonna be all right, gonna be okay.
A poem for this morning. Sorrow Is Not My Name by Ross Gay, after Gwendolyn Brooks. No matter the pull toward the brink, no matter the florid, deep sleep awaits, there is a time for everything. Look, just this morning, a vulture nodded his red, grizzled head at me, and I looked at him, admiring the sickle of his beak. Then the wind kicked up, and after arranging his good suit of feathers, he up and took off. Just like that. And to boot, there are, on this planet alone, something like 2 million naturally occurring sweet things, some with names so generous as to kick the steel from my knees. Agave, persimmon, stickball, the purple okra that I bought for $2 at the market. Think of that. The long night, the skeleton in the mirror, the man behind me on the bus taking notes. Yeah, yeah, but look, my niece is running through a field calling my name. My neighbor sings like an angel. And at the end of my block, there is a basketball court. I remember. My color's green. I'm spring.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good. Fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on a tree, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. Dragonfly out in the sun, you know what I mean, don't you know? Butterflies all having fun, you know what I mean. Sleep in peace when day is done, that's what I mean. And this old world is a new world, and a bold world for me. Stars, when you shine, you know how I feel. Scent of the pine, you know how I feel. Oh, freedom isn't mine, and I know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good. I feel so good. I feel
It's one way of saying hallelujah, folks. Did you all hear that thunder last night? Yes, wasn't that incredible? How many of you had pets hiding under the sofa, right? And that lightning? Did you see that? For those of you joining us online who are not here in Santa Barbara, we had this huge storm come through this weekend. Somewhere about 3 inches over the past 48 hours, there was hail. There were flooded highways. Maybe that anxiety that comes after we've been through so much here with rain events. We even had 19 minutes of a tornado warning in the middle of Friday night. Most of us slept through it. So when this flash flood warning buzzed on my phone last night, I was thinking about this morning and how our choir, our wonderful choir, might have to come here and sing Light of a Clear Blue Morning in the middle of a downpour, right? They would have to get up early and rehearse singing to us that everything was gonna be okay, that a new day was dawning, even if it wasn't okay. Yet, shaking the wet droplets off their coats and umbrellas, I imagined the choir arriving, chatting perhaps with one another about this dramatic weather. And boy, they brought the sunshine with them here into the sanctuary this morning, didn't they? And it's Easter, so of course we're going to sing about joy. Whether the sky is dark with clouds or sunny and blue, we are going to plan for hope. We're going to make the sun shine in here no matter what the weather brings us out there. And Matthew bringing the spirit of Nina Simone into the room with us, telling us about a new dawn, a new day, a new life, how good it can feel to be alive and free in this world. And for a few minutes, I can be here with that feeling, joy, right here. Freedom of spirit, the lightness of a bird in the air, a new day right now. Could it be? Could it be, like the poet Ross Gay just said, could it be true that our color might be green? The color of growth, of new life, of transformation? In this world of sorrow, in this pull toward the brink, as he said, could we be named and claimed by joy instead? Green is literally the color of transformation. It is the color of chlorophyll, a magic molecule in plants that takes sunlight, that actually pulls sunlight from the air and transforms it into a tree or a flower. Or a fruit. These flowers here on Easter, these are sunlight transformed. You fine people, all of you are alive right now because you are sunlight transformed. If that's not a joyful thought, then I don't know what is. My colleague, the Reverend Julian Jamaica Soto, once said that the stories we tell are like prisms, and a good metaphor separates out the colors of the human experience so we can see more clearly the light that we are made of. A story like the Easter story that's been around for over 2,000 years, a story like that, it's a prism that shines out this rainbow of meaning when we turn it this way and that. And so each year, I pick up this text and I shine a light through it and I turn it around and try to see which of the colors catch my eye, which seems to speak to this moment. And this year, it was green, the color of new life, transforming us from sunlight into growth. Green, the color of joy, refusing to let us wither. What I found in the Easter story this year is a reminder also that we don't have to know how the story ends to find transformative joy all along the way. The people in that story, they didn't know where it would go. But over and over again, they were given messages of joy to sustain them. We can be in the middle of the road, our eyes cast down and carrying the weight of the world in our hearts, just trying to get from one place to the next, and boom, joy can show up walking beside us. We can be expecting to wrestle with a heavy stone of grief and instead find a surprising invitation to more life. We can resign ourselves to the brutal violence of empire and then be reminded that love is something that cannot be killed or taken by force. These are some of the things that happen in the Easter story. When two of Jesus' disciples were walking on the road to Emmaus, they're absorbed in thinking and talking about their loss and their grief, and they're wondering what will become of their small revolutionary band after their prophet had been killed, when this stranger who's been walking next to them along the road for a while suddenly is revealed to be their beloved teacher, transformed and resurrected. Joy suddenly flooding back to them as they rush to tell their friends what had happened. And the women, the first who arrived at the tomb that morning, carrying with them those oils and spices, ready to touch death itself as they prepare his body for burial. Instead of being greeted by death, they're greeted by angels in beautiful shimmering robes and a message that life is what they should seek, not death. And this vision of Jesus, transformed and unrecognizable at first, startles Mary Magdalene, and he asks her, "Why are you weeping?" So she dries her tears and remembers that sorrow is not her name. And that final story of the resurrection, when Jesus appears to the disciples and, to quote Luke, while in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering. Well, in the midst of their joy, while they were disbelieving and still wondering, he eats and drinks with them. Their wonder, their doubts, their questions, they did not stop them from experiencing joy. Joy and uncertainty can exist side by side. Which prompts me to ask that when we go through a time of transformation, why do we so often feel like we have to hold off on joy until we get to the end of the story, until everything is made clear? Why do we delay delight, waiting until all of the defeats and victories are calculated, the outcome is secure? Why do we have to know every unintended consequence first before we allow ourselves to find joy? Too often we treat joy like a reward at the end of a struggle. We wait to celebrate until the legislation is passed and the court case is won and the disease is in remission and the diploma is in hand. We don't want to break out the champagne too early, lest we look foolish if things fail. And friends, things always fail on any journey along the way. We don't want to seem naive or ignorant or gullible. We don't want to be made fun of for finding joy. Wisdom in our modern world is often seen as something that should go hand in hand with cynicism, a brutal, clear-eyed assessment of reality, a somber expression. But when did joy become associated with being gullible and naive? Reading these Easter stories, the way the authors tell it, joy is the opposite of naivete. It's when the truth is revealed, when their eyes are opened, that joy comes back. And what opened their eyes over and over again in this story? It wasn't stability. It wasn't security, but transformation and change and possibility. This is what brought joy. It wasn't certain victory over their enemies. It wasn't retribution that brought them joy, but the resurrection of love and the possibilities and the hope that arises when love refuses to die. The material circumstances of those disciples in the story hadn't changed. The empire was still there the day after resurrection. The Romans didn't pack up and leave. The world hadn't fixed itself on that day after. The characters in this Easter story, they were living through dangerous times, and they had no idea how it would all work out. For them, something strange and terrible, but also wonderful and transformative, was going on. They were living in the middle of the story. We are always, all of us, living in the middle of the story. But their teacher had instilled in them this sense that love and justice were something that they could find in this life, something they could aspire towards and work towards, not just in the afterlife. They had found there a community, a group of people dedicated to this emerging vision of a more loving world. And in the story, it is explicitly said in the text that Jesus told them that they would grieve, but that they would also find joy. A joy that no one would be able to take from them ever, no matter what happened. And with that joy alongside the transformation, they discovered that they could live and survive through change. They could survive uncertainty. They could resist dehumanizing violence. They could imagine peace. They could build on that hope for a better world. And they could trust that joy would show up, not just in some far-off heaven, but as resurgent as life itself. Can we trust that joy too? Not in a heaven and salvation way, but trust in joy the way a tree trusts in spring, the way sunlight gives itself up to the transformation into a flower, the way sorrow never has the last word because the story is not over. Our color is green. We are spring. May it be so. Blessed be, and amen. And for those of you who've been waiting to sing some more Alleluias, now's your chance. We are going to sing together Jah's Alleluia, 1050 in the teal hymnal, Please Rise in Body and Spirit. Matthew's going to lead us through it.
I'm going to sing it a couple times through, and then I'll lead us in a round, okay?
Alleluia, Alleluia. Alleluia, 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 Alleluia.
Wonderful.
So stay right where you are. And if you want to hold hands with someone, you can ask the person next to you if you can hold hands with them or put their hand on your hand on their shoulder. Or if you'd prefer just to put your hands over your heart or hold your hands open wherever you are, here in this room or out in the world, get connected to one another. Feel that love that moves within us and beyond us. And as you go out into this rainy and sunny and beautiful and heartbreaking world, may the light of love shine upon you, out from within you, be gracious unto you, and bring you peace. For this is the day we are given. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And let us call out an Easter blessing.
Call out a blessing, call out a blessing. Oh.